tales for dark nights.
The following performance is a second round entry in the 2017 Evil Idol voice acting competition. Voting is simple. Following the performance, simply click the thumbs up icon on this video if you'd like them to become a member of the team, or the thumbs down if you'd rather they not. Voting on this entry will conclude 1 week after the date of its posting. Good luck to all of our contestants.
We'd all known Dennis had less than a week, and we'd all braced ourselves for all the good that would do. This was going to tear us apart and leave a ragged, gaping hole in all our lives, but that would be it. It would fit within our understanding of things, and we could all assume he went wherever we thought people go. That would have been so much easier, so much less troubling than what actually happened. Dennis had been diagnosed with cancer a couple of days after his 10th birthday, and it was all downhill from there. There was never an upswing, never an opportunity for surgery. All the scans showed the same thing, the oily black webs having grown larger and denser. The fact that we were twins and had looked identical right up to when he started chemo just made it worse. There I was, right beside him, a perfect image of what he used to be before his hair fell out and his color drained and his cheeks sunk down into his skull. An emaciated ghost constantly contrasted with what he should be. And then the doctor finally shut the case, snuffed out the last wisps of hope. Dennis will most likely not last more than 4 days, a week at most. So we'd all set up camp in his musty room at the hospital. The walls were freckled and pea green, the only light slanted in from between the shutters, glaring bars stretching out across the floor to end just short of Dennis's bed. The staff managed to bring in another, simpler bed for me, and my parents slept in old wicker chairs. Dennis looked really bad at this stage. You could as well as see a skull. We all wanted to talk to him, to make the most of whatever time was left, but he slept most of the day, and when he woke up, there'd just be silence. Nobody knew what to say, there were no right words, and there was this underlying fear that the moment anybody interacted with the situation, they'd somehow make it real and it would hit everyone. The first sound would knock us all off the tightrope, and we'd fall into tears and chaos, and we wouldn't be able to pull ourselves back up. So there was silence, my parents occasionally forcing smiles that never made it to their eyes. The third day was when it finally happened, when the steady beeping of the heart monitor started to break down into frantic electronic wails, and Dennis began to shake feebly as a dry, crackling sound rose up from his mouth. My parents exploded out of their chairs, my mother heading straight to Dennis, grabbing his shoulders and pleading with him to stop it and be all right, and my father was at the room door screaming down the hallways for help. The doctors and nurses at the hospital had changed lately. They'd started treating Dennis differently. Before the resuscitations, there were always these frantic, desperate efforts like 100-meter sprints. There was a desperate desire to succeed in every single movement. Now it was different, more like a steady jog. These were people who were going through the motions, ticking off things they were meant to try from little checklists in their minds. I don't know if it would have made a difference either way. The cancer had finally tipped over and his system just couldn't shoulder it anymore. They'd called it and left, offering their condolences and saying they'd take away the body when we were ready. The door clicked shut behind them and then there was just us, me, Mom, Dad, and Dennis's corpse. We all inched closer up to the side of his bed and just looked. My mother cracked, breaking into great howling tears. My father pulled her close, trying to keep it together, but losing it in his own way. No sobs from him, just the occasional tear running down his face and sharp breaths bursting through his clenched teeth. I was just quietly staring at Dennis's face. We all stood there for a long time. I finally realized that this wasn't just one thing. This wasn't a single event. For the first time, my mind started running away with itself and unfolding all these endless implications, every one of them causing my gut to sink and for me to miss him so much, even though he'd just been here. I was never going to talk to him again. He was never going to laugh at me again. We were never eating dinner again. We were never going to school together again. We were never going to be in the same class in school again or talk during classes at school again. It just kept going and going as I realized that this wasn't just one person I'd lost. I'd lost a million things. Something that was meant to be this constant presence was gone, and nothing would ever be as good as it should be again. Everything I was going to do would be soured by the certainty that I wouldn't be doing it with him, or that I wouldn't be able to tell him about it later. I was the first to see his lips quiver. "Mom? Dad? His lips are moving." My parents froze, still clasped against each other, my mother curled over and supported by my father. We looked down as his lips continued to quiver. My parents went quiet again. They must have been trying to hold back hope, assuming it was some kind of nervous tic, but it kept going, and finally, in a dusty, hoarse voice, so faint it was like you were hearing it on the wind, he said my name. "Harry." My father sprinted across the room, yelling for the nurses to come back. My mother was clutching her mouth and stumbling back from the bed. The workers tumbled back in and went through the checklist and shocked him with the defibrillators a few times and reached their verdict. "We're sorry, he's still dead." "But I heard him talk," said my father in a small, pleading voice. "Look, it could have been gas escaping, but..." said my father, before a tiny scraping sound cut through the room, everyone turning towards its source. It was coming from Dennis, halfway between a sigh and a croak.
"Harry, it's so dark, so cold, so dark, and it's pulling down, pulling at my insides and taking me down."
A moment later, nurses started on their rounds again, but this wasn't some perfunctory run through the checklist. You could see it on their faces in how hurried their movements were. They didn't know what was happening. They weren't even sure they were doing the right thing. They moved on to the defibrillator again, sending crashing waves of power through Dennis's chest before listening with a stethoscope.
"Doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense," one was mumbling.
After 10 minutes, they all just stepped back. They'd run the checklist out. Nothing had happened.
"What's happening?"
my mother screamed. One of the men, a doctor, I think, answered.
"Nothing is happening. We try and pump in oxygen, and it does nothing. There's no pulse, and we can't induce one for more than a second or two. The body temperature's down 3 degrees. He's gone."
"But we heard him," I said.
"I know, but he's dead."
The dry grating came again, and everyone shut up.
"Please, Harry, where are you?"
I walked over to his side. I wasn't relieved he was talking. I was only afraid. This was wrong. I wanted to run. I wanted him to just be gone so I could cry with my parents and be done with it. But I kept walking and put my hand on his bony, cold, and clearly dead hand.
"I'm here,"
I said.
"I can see gray. A little bit of gray, but it's so far away. I don't just see it, I feel it, I feel it, and I never knew something could be so far away. I'm already so far down, but I need to go so much further to get to the gray."
I didn't know how to respond, so I just stood there and I listened to him talk about the darkness and the distant gray smudge. Sometimes he'd answer me, sometimes he wouldn't. A lot of stuff happened around me in the next few hours. Everyone who worked at the hospital must have been in and out. Even my parents started to leave sometimes when they accepted I was the only one Dennis seemed to be aware of. Dennis was looked at by every type of doctor they had in there, and nobody understood. They'd gotten desperate and had put Dennis in an fMRI machine. They'd fully prepped a corpse and put it in a machine for the living. My entire family was in the room. A cold, confused fear had settled in my gut, making me feel a little bit like throwing up.
"I think we've got something," said the technician, who was looking at the monitors.
Please, just tell us what's happening, said my mother. She'd moved past terror and hope and was now, above all else, exhausted, her red face slack and empty. Look, this scan looks for where the blood is in the brain. Well, the thing is that none of the blood in the brain is moving. We know that from his pulse, but something is happening in there. Something the machine can only pick up a little. But there is some kind of activity. Now, I can't be sure, but I think the activity is clustered around some of the parts that control movement. Everything else is totally dead. He's obviously conscious. He's using complete sentences, but what? Said my father. But it's like whatever's doing, the thinking is somewhere else, still interacting with the stuff that does the talking.
That's exactly right, came a voice behind us.
I looked over my shoulder and saw an old man in a gray business suit. He had a well-trimmed silver beard and was all around a strange contrast to the clumsy chaos that had engulfed the hospital. Who are you? Said the technician.
I'm Daniel Cohen, he said, handing the technician a crisp business card. I'm with the Orpheus Institute. We're a semi-private medical research body, and we've dealt with a few cases similar to this one. The hospital president has already agreed to let us look into this.
Almost invisibly, a number of men had moved in behind Cohen and were now making their way over to the technician.
These men will help explain the confidentiality situation surrounding issues like this. We'll handle the boy from here.
More men, these ones in pure white scrubs that had a strange logo on the left breast, got Dennis back on the stretcher and led us all into the hallway. We followed wordlessly, never thinking to say anything because at least these new people represented new possibilities, a completely new road that might lead to an explanation. They rolled Dennis into an operating theater and my mother gasped.
Look, just what are you doing? Said my father
in a husky voice that made it obvious he was still holding in tears. Cohen, who had just been striding ahead of the stretcher with a speed that belied his age, had stopped once we got to the theater and was now taking deliberate care to look all three of us in the eyes. We were still in the hallway, the operating theater door shut behind us. He answered in a low, comfortable tone.
We're not performing surgery. It's just the quietest part of the hospital, and there are no distractions in there. We want nothing more than to understand what has happened to your son. This sort of thing has happened before. Your son is conscious, and as we understand, he will only talk to his brother here. We want to use Harry to ask Dennis our questions. We believe this would work best if he and Harry were alone. We've got the theater wired so that we can hear the answers.
Thank you for listening. If you haven't already, don't forget to cast your vote for this contestant via either a thumbs up or thumbs down vote. New entries will be posted throughout July. Be sure to tune in and vote for each of them and help decide who becomes the next evil idol. In the meantime, turn off the lights and turn on the dark. Chilling Tales for Dark Nights.